Good morning, everyone. I realize that everybody is waiting for the great debate coming soon. But first, it's my pleasure to give you my presentation on the new drug delivery systems and the implications for treatment and prevention. So these are my disclosures. And what I'm going to do in the next 20 to 25 minutes is to talk with you what could be the reasons that we are looking for new drug delivery systems. We already have many tablets, capsules available, so what's the reason to look for something different? And when we are looking for new formulations, what are the criteria, both for the systems and for the drugs, to be used in these new formulations? There already are a couple of new formulations being studied, and I will present some of the pharmacokinetic data that support the use of these formulations in clinical trials. And I will briefly summarize some of the data from these clinical studies using the new drug delivery systems, both for treatment and for prevention of HIV. And then I will finish with one final slide about the future perspectives for this area. So the main question to start off is really what could be the reason to look for new drug delivery systems, because as we all know, the current, especially the first line combination therapies that we have, they are highly effective. If you take them, of course, they are relatively well tolerated and more or less convenient to use. Most are fixed dose combinations. Most of them can be taken once a day, limited food restrictions, especially if you compare it to what we have 10 or 20 years ago. And most patients can adhere to the current combination formulations. And it's also known that some patients, however, do have a problem with taking these medications day by day. And how large that proportion of some patients is debatable. It can be 5% or 10% maybe. But if you look at, let's say, the population of HIV-infected patients around the world, more than 30 million, then 5 or 10% of such a large number is still a reasonable number of patients that have problems in benefiting from these medications. And not only in terms of the number of patients, but also in terms of the duration of the treatment. As we know that HIV can be a chronic condition if treated well, it may mean that patients have to take these medications, even if it's simple for them to do that, maybe for 40 or 50 years. So that's a very long time to take medication. And then if you think about options for less frequent dosing, that may help both patients who now all are fully adherent on the current regimen, but just to offer them more convenience and also less stigma, because if they can take a medication and don't have to think about it for the next 30 days or maybe the next couple of months, that can help reducing the stigma. And also it could be very helpful for patients who now have, let's say, imperfect adherence. So they have problems, even if the medication is not that difficult to take, they still can have problems taking these medications. And if you make it easier for them, maybe you have improved adherence and also improved efficacy. And we will talk a lot about PrEP during this conference. We already heard about it, and we will have a debate on it coming soon. But you can think whether really daily intake of PrEP is preferable, and whether it can be and will be effective for a long time if people will have to do that for maybe 10 or 20 years or even longer. And then taking PrEP on demand with all kinds of issues around that, or PrEP as being a long-acting formulation so that people are protected for weeks or even months after they had taken that medication. Maybe that's more an effective way of prevention. Well, we are going to see some of the data about that. But before we go talk about the various formulations and the drugs being studied, let's first look at some data that have been collected, whether there's any interest by patients about taking long-acting antiretrovirals. So if you ask patients, what they think about taking an injection, for instance, that has a long-acting duration. Are they interested, yes or no? And this is from a survey that was published a couple of years ago, where you can see that if you ask patients whether they have any interest, then there is quite some percentage, about 40%, who definitely have an interest in taking a long-acting injection. And you can imagine that that interest is increasing if they have to take an injection less frequently. So for instance, at the right part of the slide, if they only have to take it once per month, then the interest increases to 60-70%. But even if they have to take that injection every week, so once per week, which you could say is a relatively small difference versus taking an oral tablet once a day, then still you can see that there can be 30-40% of patients who definitely have an interest in taking such injection. And if you then focus a little bit on what kind of persons may have more or less interest in taking these injections, you can, for instance, look at age as a factor. And in this graph, you can see that across all ages, there is certainly an interest in taking these injections, but that interest may even be larger in the younger people. So if you look at the two bars at the left, so patients who definitely or probably have an interest in taking such injections, that is the largest proportion, up to 70-80%, if you look at the younger group of patients. And not very surprising, but important to realize. And then also, if you look at patients who admit that they may have forgotten some of the doses in the last week, or forgotten medications at an earlier stage, you can imagine that especially those patients who have some adherence problems, they have a higher interest in taking these long-acting injections. So not that very surprising, but also important to see. So not all patients are the same. Some may have an interest in these long-acting injections more than others. And it's very important to think about these subpopulations who may benefit from new drug delivery systems. So if you think about what could be the criteria for such new drug delivery systems, you can look at a number of different criteria. We often think about injectables as being the formulation for long-acting antiretrovirals, but it's not the only way. You even have drugs that can be taken orally and have a very long half-life. Is it still on? Yeah. Have a very long half-life, and you can take it maybe once a month or even less frequently. But if you look at the injectables, then very important for ARVs to be suitable for an injection is that you can give it at a low dose. Of course, you can imagine if you have to give ARVs at a very high dose and a high number of milligrams or even grams, that can be difficult to have in a small volume, and people don't want to be injected with large volumes. What is possible for some of these agents is that you can formulate it in what we call a nanosuspension, which means that the drug is dissolved in very small particles, and not all ARVs have the physical chemical factors that make them suitable for suspension. So you cannot do it with any ARV. And what is very important is that these drugs, they stay for a long time in the body, not necessarily because they are eliminated slowly, but because they are released very slowly. And that's the predominant factor, that due to the slow release from such a nanosuspension, for example, that means that they will remain in the body for a very long time. More or less the same criteria you can think of when we talk about implantables. So you already saw a picture earlier this morning that some of the ARVs can be used as an implant, like the hormonal contraceptives or some antipsychotics that already have been developed. Also there you need a low dose, of course, otherwise the implant will be too large. What is very attractive for an implant is that it can be removed. So if there's any side effects or any reason that you want to stop or you need to stop the administration of the drug, both for treatment or for prevention, that it can be removed, which of course is not the same with an injection suspension, which is already there in the body. And also for an implant, it means that the elimination from that implant is really dictating how long the drug will be in the body. So these are the criteria for some of these new drug delivery systems. And there's actually one oral drug that is now being tested, and that is called the EFDA drug, where a phase one study has been presented. This is a single dose that is given to patients, where you can see that it results in a very strong decline in the viral load over many days or even weeks, just with one single dose. And it means that this is a very effective drug just already on its own. And there are a couple of questions now that I know the company is thinking about for the next coming years. Should this drug be developed for treatment, or should it be developed for prevention, or maybe for both? And then very important questions are, what is the optimal dose frequency? Can you really give it once a week, and is that already a clear advantage, or can you give it once a month? And especially for treatment, it's not very likely that this will be effective just on its own as a monotherapy. So probably for treatment at least, it needs a second drug, a partner drug. And there you have a problem that with the oral administration, there are in fact no other drugs that you can give orally that have this very long elimination half-life. So that it's a very good drug, but at this moment on its own, and especially for treatment, probably we need a second drug. Then the next drug, which is so far the most relevant and most well-known drug for long-acting, you already heard about it also this morning, the cabotegravir, which is only a slight modification from dolutegravir. So dolutegravir, as we know, for the treatment of HIV quite for some time. And now we have cabotegravir, which is specifically developed for long-acting formulation. It can be used either by intramuscular injection or by subcutaneous injection. And now it's being clinically tested, both for treatment and prevention, in intramuscular injection. And it has, because of this very slow release from a nanosuspension, it has a very long half-life. So for 1 to 2 months half-life, which is very convenient for less frequent dosing. This is a graph of the pharmacokinetics of several administrations of the cabotegravir, tested in various dosing regimens. Important to see that the drug already has effective concentrations shortly after the administration, so it's very important for treatment and also for prevention, of course, that you don't have to wait for a very long time before it's becoming effective. So it's already effective quite shortly after the administration, and it will remain in the body for several weeks or even months after the last administration. So you can see the curve is relatively high above what you need for optimal viral inhibition. So it's well developed, and the dose is well tested now for cabotegravir. It has been shown that, of course, there is always some kind of variability in the pharmacokinetics between patients, and especially patients who had a low BMI or male patients had a faster absorption and thus also a faster excretion of the agent. Okay, thank you. Cabotegravir has not been tested just on its own. It has also been tested as a combination with a second drug, especially for the treatment. And the companion drug that was chosen is wilpivirine. And bupivacaine, we all know, for the treatment of HIV, which already has a relatively long half-life. But also bupivacaine at a relatively small dose can be used as a nanosuspension, and then you can make use of this slow release from that suspension with a long elimination half-life. The difference, however, is that the concentrations that you find in the body with the bupivacaine are much closer to what we normally see with the QD administration of bupivacaine. So although it's long-acting and there's a long elimination half-life after release from the nanosuspension, the levels that you actually get in the body are closer to what you need if you compare it to cabotegravir. So these two drugs are combined, but they clearly don't have the same pharmacokinetics. They have been tested in what is called the LATE-2 study, just recently published in The Lancet. And there the study was comparing two different methods for administration, either once per month or once per 2 months, so 8 weeks. And you can see that overall the efficacy of both regimen was comparable to oral administration, so the control arm. But you can also see some differences. So for instance, if you look at the curve for the virological non-response, there was more non-response in the patients who took this combination every 8 weeks. So it was a small difference, but there were more failures in the group that took the medication every 8 weeks. On the other hand, you can also see there were more discontinuation because of adverse events in the patients who took this injection every month, so every 4 weeks. So they had some toxicity, although it was relatively well tolerated, but there was a little bit more toxicity in the once per month administration. So that shows that there's a little bit of a problem in this combination. For the toxicity, you would like to give it every 2 months, but for the efficacy, you would like to give it every month. So it's a little bit a balance between efficacy and toxicity in this combination. And especially if you look at the specific side effects that were mentioned by these patients, you can see that the injection site pain was more frequent in the once per month group. And also, a little bit surprising maybe, but also other adverse events like nausea and headache were occurring more in the once per month versus the once per 2 months regimen. So although it's the best that we have at the moment, you can question whether this is really an optimal combination for treatment of HIV using a long-acting antiviral combination. If you look at the pharmacokinetics, as I already mentioned to you, there are some differences between these two drugs. So on the left panel, you see the pharmacokinetics of the cabotegravir, which is relatively stable and between the lines as you would like to have these concentrations. On the right side, you see the bupivacaine levels, which are more variable, and also for some patients, they are relatively low. And then there was a more detailed analysis of the virological failures in the once per 2 months administration. It was found that 7 out of 9 non-responders actually had low bupivacaine levels. So due to this variability that you also have with long-acting antivirals, there is a risk that if the dose is not selected correctly, that there could be some failures due to low exposure, which in this case apparently was true for bupivacaine. So what are now, to my opinion, the future perspective of this combination? It probably will be the first long-acting combination to be licensed. Just to add that information that you always have to give an oral lead-in of this combination because you don't know whether patients can tolerate this combination and you cannot start directly with the injection. You first have to take it orally and if the patient can tolerate it, you can change to the injection. It probably will be licensed as a once per month intramuscular injection. And you can imagine, you can ask yourself what kind of patients are eligible for such a long-acting once per month injection. Maybe not necessarily the patients who don't have any problems with daily intake, but those who have problems with adherence, even with the easy fixed dose combinations, maybe those are the candidates for this once per month long-acting combination. We have to see in clinical practice whether these injection site reactions already mentioned by the study participants, how people in real life will actually tolerate that. And if especially for those who don't have any toxicity from the oral medications taking daily, maybe they don't like a once per month injection, which is painful to them. So I think there are also a couple of other questions. What we don't know is what will happen if patients do not show up for their next appointment. So because these drugs are in the body for such a long time, if they don't show up and they don't come back to you, they will actually have periods of maybe monotherapy with either cabotegravir or vilpivirine, just depending on which drug is there for the longest time, depending on variability. And if you then have monotherapy, of course, you have the possibility of development of resistance, what, of course, we don't want. Another problem, especially also for here and other regions in the world, is that if a patient develops TB, he needs to be treated, for instance, with rifampin. You have a drug interaction, and that cannot be combined with the injection. So in that case, you have to go over to the oral administration, as you do now, and you cannot continue with your injection medication. Another question, also relevant, especially if we're going to treat younger patients with this combination, if women become pregnant, will the drug levels be high enough during pregnancy and continue viral suppression? Or also the same as with the TB treatment, do we have to change to oral medication during pregnancy? And there are no data, as far as I know at this moment, about children and adolescents being treated with this combination. And I know there are some simulations of what could be the optimal doses for this combination, but no clinical data as far as I know. Then moving to the other new drug delivery system, the implantables. This is again the same drug that I just showed you with the oral administration, the FDA, which apparently is maybe perfect for as an implant, because it has a very slow release from that implant. And you can see on the X scale that if you have one implant, it can be there for 6 months or even maybe for a year, which is, of course, very attractive for especially prevention. So again, like the oral formulation, will this implant be further developed for treatment or maybe better for prevention? Optimal dose frequency, we don't know. Maybe, as I said, maybe every 6 months, every 12 months. Do we need a partner drug for treatment? Probably yes, but for prevention, maybe no. And maybe you could say that there's no need for oral lead-in, because if there's any toxicity, you can remove the implant and resolve the toxicity. So I think there are a couple of attractive aspects in this drug for implants. So far, I mostly talked about the treatment, but if you look at long-acting antivirals for prevention, we all know that the efficacy of PrEP is highly dependent on adherence. And we also know that, in general, for patients, adherence for prophylaxis is less than for treatment. So we will see in the future, with all the PrEP being around, that there will be less adherence to PrEP, and that can have a problem. And maybe if you can give one antiretroviral for prevention, which has a long-acting duration, that could be sufficient for that purpose. So I think that's maybe even more than for treatment, the future for the long-acting antivirals. There are a couple of PrEP trials already ongoing. You saw it early in the morning on the slide. Two large phase three studies are ongoing with this cabotegravir every 8 weeks, probably for prevention. Every 8 weeks is perfect. And we will look for the data. Of course, it will take some time before we have some of the results. But very important trials for this long-acting formulation of cabotegravir. So to finish the future perspectives and the conclusions from the long-acting antivirals, I think I would like to start with some general comments. We have quite a lack of data on the various subpopulations. As I said, no data on adolescent, pregnancy, etc. We don't have any information at this moment what will happen for patients who are lost to follow-up. Will there be any resistance development, and how frequently we will see that? And also an aspect that has not yet been covered, what will be the cost of these new drug delivery systems? So it can be much easier for patients to take, but at what price will it be on the market? And if it will be too expensive, then of course that will be a barrier to implementation. I think that for HIV treatment with these long-acting, we really have to look in the future what will be the tolerability of, for instance, the cabotegravir-rilpivirine combinations, how people will like the injections, how may tolerate the injection site pain that they will cover. And really the question is whether the monthly injection, as it probably will be on the label, is really a significant benefit over daily overdosing. Again, if patients are perfectly adherent and don't have any toxicity, I don't think that a monthly painful injection is really the way forward. And we could question ourselves whether this particular combination, although it's the best that we have, cabotegravir-rilpivirine, is it really the perfect combination? For prevention, I'm a little bit more optimistic. So I think really the 8-weekly injection of cabotegravir or the implants, that could be very attractive if you can give that every 6 to 12 months. And we assume, but we are not sure, that monotherapy will be as effective as dual prevention. And maybe the most important comment I would like to make is that at this moment we are looking at the data on long-acting antivirals with the current drugs that we have. But maybe we have to wait for a couple of years more, and that in 5 or 10 years we will have developed new drugs and new formulations that are more suitable for both treatment and prevention with long-acting antivirals. So with that, I would like to acknowledge Professor Kouriskes, who gave a talk on the same subject a couple of months ago, and was happy to share some of his slides with me so I could make use of that for the preparation of my talk. And I would like to thank you for the invitation and for your attention. Thank you.